Welcome everyone to the Merivale Fallowfield Pastoral Charge, where we are committed to practicing God's radical love and inclusion. Our charge believes worship is intended to radicalize us, change us, and form us into faithful followers of the compassionate teachings of Jesus. We are still not meeting in person, but that doesn't stop us from doing our best to meet the needs of others in our community. There are many organizations in need of donations now more than ever. The Elizabeth Fry Society, Center 507, Ottawa Mission, and local food banks are just a few that need your generosity during these difficult times. You can find a list of these services and more on our website. As you know, the pandemic is not over until it is over for everyone. The United Church of Canada has a campaign called Pay It Forward. The campaign urges people to advocate, donate, and buy a vaccine to be administered in the Global South, where pandemic-related suffering continues to increase. Pay It Forward offers the chance to buy a vaccine for just $25 for someone in a country where vaccines are in short supply and are distributed through UNICEF's networks. Apparently, the donations will now be matched by government funds. You can find out more about this by going to https://united-church.ca/news/matching-vaccine-donations. We will have this link posted on our website. If you would like to donate to the church, you can do so online by e-transfer to muchurch@bellnet.ca, or you can send a check to either Merivale or Fallowfield Church. You can find each address on our website, www.merivalefallowfield.org. These are all the announcements at this time, and now we hope that you will sit back, relax, and feel God's presence with you during this worship. We begin our service today with the lighting of the Christ candle. As we gather for worship today, may God's love be upon us. As we gather for worship today, may the peace of Jesus rest on us. As we gather for worship today, may we hear the Spirit speak to us through song, prayer, and reflection. May our worship ignite in us a desire to share the peace and love of God with others. Amen. Thank you.
Let us gather our hearts together for a time of prayer. O God, we come to worship you on this first Sunday in September, and we come joining our hearts together as one during this sacred hour. With each new worship, we are offered another opportunity to learn about your love as we walk along on this sacred journey of life. Your Spirit invites us to be mindful of the many ways our lives are made better just by knowing and embracing the teachings of Jesus. And we thank you for your grace and your unconditional love that we experience every day. Today we acknowledge that we are pilgrims in search of the Holy Land that seems to exist only in our dreams. And we pray that you will show us the path that leads to Jesus' radical theology of inclusion. We yearn to hear the stories of Jesus that call us to have no part in anything that divides humanity instead of uniting us together. Spirit of the journey, God of many names and manifestations, help us to boldly open our hearts so that we may be able to venture eagerly forward, accepting all that each new step has to offer us. May we believe in a good world that is a safe place for all people. And may we know that within the journey itself lies our destination, and that the new kingdom come on earth waits to be discovered in every heart. May each of us in our own sacred space and time find a place for reflection on how we can embrace the teachings of Jesus in our lives. And hear us now as we pray the ancient prayer of our ancestors. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our first reading is James chapter 2, verses 1 through 8 and 14 through 17. My brothers and sisters, do you with your acts of favoritism really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, and if you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, have a seat here, please, while to the one who is poor you say, stand there, or sit at my feet, have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters, has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. Our second reading is Mark chapter 7, verses 24 through 37. From there he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice, but a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. But she answered him, sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Then he said to her, for saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter. So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of Decapolis. They brought him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hands on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, and put his fingers into his ears, and then spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, Emphatapha, that is, be opened. And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, he has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts always be aligned with your love, O God. Amen. In our story by the author of Mark's Gospel, Jesus has just arrived in the region of Tyre in an effort to secure some badly needed rest. Of course, because he was becoming a superstar preacher and healer, he could not escape notice. One woman in particular heard about his arrival, and she was determined to meet with him. And this woman was from the borders of Tyre and Sidon, and is described as a Greek, a Syrophoenician by race. This meant that she was of Canaanite descent, a native of the Phoenician seaboard, Greek in religion, and probably also in speech. Anyhow, she asked Jesus to save her daughter from an unclean spirit. And when Jesus responds to the woman's request, he sounds incredibly harsh to me. He seems to set up what appears to be an exclusive boundary-setting statement. Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take their food and throw it to dogs. In other words, it is not right to feed food to you, Gentiles, to you, the unclean people. His calling Gentiles dogs seems to contradict his earlier openness and conforms to the exclusionary perspective shaped by the dogma of his faith tradition. And yet, were not those the very traditions he had spent so much time challenging? So we have to ask ourselves why. Why is Jesus upholding the very intolerance he has previously condemned? Well, there are many, many sermons and reflections on this passage, and there are so many good explanations of why Jesus was so hard on this woman. I have to wonder if Jesus was using this moment as a teaching opportunity for his disciples, who, let's face it, most of the time found it difficult to accept his boundary-breaking movement. Did Jesus know that this woman, who was so desperate to have her daughter healed, would rise and join him in this teaching moment? Whatever the case may be, this woman acknowledges that in the eyes of Judaism of the time, she is considered to be unclean. She knows that. Jesus isn't telling her anything new. But this woman has heard stories about the compassion of Jesus, And so she appeals to the Jesus she has heard about. She appeals to the same universal understanding of God that Jesus himself has taught along his travels. She courageously calls out this formidable rabbi and declares that although a dog may be unclean and therefore lower than even a child in a household, the dog is a valued part of God's creation nonetheless. She takes the statement of Jesus and turns it on its head. And so moved with compassion for this woman, and I'm sure amazed at her courage, Jesus heals her daughter. If you are like me, you cheer at the end of this story, because the universal Jesus is back. The boundary-breaking Jesus and this woman have just made history. In this story, the line Jesus had drawn between him and the woman disappeared, and you could almost hear the huge wheels of history turning as in front of everyone, Jesus proves who he really is, and that is the universal rabbi. He declares what he has been called to do, and that is to break down any barriers that exist between humans. This powerful lesson teaches us that God is not the God of one tribe or the God of one religion. God is not the God of one people, but is a universal God. This story teaches us that division among people is certainly not how we are meant to live. Now, our reading from the letter of James tells us that we are not to make distinctions between each other, but we are to fulfill the royal law of loving our neighbor as ourselves. And according to James, we fulfill the royal law by taking action. And that means seeing the whole human race as our family and neighbors, and moving forward promoting this new paradigm so that we can take care of each other regardless of our many differences. So according to James, if we don't fulfill the royal law, our faith is dead. You know, I am really fascinated by the science that surrounds the theory of mitochondrial Eve. In human genetics, the mitochondrial Eve is the matrilineal most recent common ancestor of all living humans. And she is defined as the most recent woman from whom all living humans descend in an unbroken line. If this theory proves true, then we are not the human race, but indeed one human family. We are all related to each other through her. And this theory can help us to open our hearts to see that the world belongs to all people. And this story in Mark's gospel tells us that the kingdom of God is a foreign woman teaching us how to live out our authentic faith tradition. The brilliance of Jesus is that he always turns things upside down. And that is what he did in this story. With the help of this woman, he challenged people's narrow-minded views of each other. And the beauty of this story is that Jesus makes it clear that the kingdom of God or the abundance of our world is not just for some people, but for all people. May this Syrophoenician woman open our hearts to the kingdom come on earth. May she teach us to wonder and dream of a world that opens doors of understanding each other. And may she teach us how to welcome the truth and wisdom that comes from our sacred stories. Amen. Let us pray. God of renewal and transformation, as we come to the end of our worship service, remind us of all the places and people in our lives that give us reason to be thankful. May we always be grateful for this sacred hour and for all the places and spaces in our lives where we experience awe. We know that these sacred spaces teach us that grace and beauty exist in this world, if we can only open our hearts to their existence. May the teachings of Jesus remind us that we are all valued members of your kingdom come and made in your image of love and compassion. And may we be grateful for these teachings, the teachings of Jesus, that help us to feel whole, just like the Syrophoenician woman. And now, O God, we pray today, we pray for our children as a new school year begins. Keep them safe as they come together in their learning. Be with them as we know many of them are experiencing anxiety because of this pandemic. Be with our teachers as they do their best to keep our children safe. As we reflect on another summer slipping away, may the warmth and the rest of summer stay with us as we take a breath and recommit to our mission of nurturing our spirits and community, in caring for one another and ourselves, and in helping to heal the divisions of the world in which we dwell. And now, O God, we just take a moment of silence to offer our own individual prayers to you. God of grace, may your spirit be with each one of us until we come together again in worship. Amen. As we head out now to do our daily tasks, may we do so with that assurance that God loves us, that Jesus is our faithful guide, and that the Holy Spirit continually offers us abundant grace. Amen.